Whoa, that was brief. That was a little bit of Jimi Hendrix, and you are a welcome to Live from the Heartland. Every Saturday morning, we're here from 9 to 10 on Live from the Heartland, hearing from good people doing good things, and artists and musicians, and today, no different. We have a stacked up show. We have royalty here with us, frankly. Blues royalty. We have Betty Kelly and Barbara Marx, who are the daughters of one Howlin Wolf. And we also will hear from T.L. Williams, a youngster with a big sound. I'm sorry to call you a youngster. It's really a sign of my elderhood. And finishing up the show today, we have Tofuku Zuburi, who just premiered his film last night at the Africans in Diaspora Film Festival down at Facets. I saw it, so I've done my homework, and we can't wait. So what do we say we start out with maybe a little Howlin Wolf to put us in the mood? Wonder if we can do that yet. While we're waiting, I'm going to let you know that our engineer, Grant Steskel, has his own show every Wednesday. And this Wednesday, it's 10 a.m. to noon, and he'll be doing a special on Wednesday in honor of our great leader, Nelson Mandela, who's maybe in his transition. God love him. Here we go. A little howling. Ow! Indeed. Yes, indeed. I'm also welcoming Lynn Orman back.
Hello, Katie. Good morning.
Who brings us all these wonderful musicians and helps us talk to them.
And the legacy of the Heartland being here for so long, and it's wonderful to bring in all of the artists that, you know, it's sort of, it's the tree, but it's the branches. We bring in the branches.
Honest to goodness.
It's wonderful.
We just were listening to Howlin Wolf playing Smokestack Lightning. And with us here today are Betty and Barbara, the daughters of Howlin Wolf. Welcome to Live from the Heartland, gals.
Thank you. Thanks for having us.
What a pleasure. And you, Betty?
Yes.
Just told me you lost your dad in 1976.
Yes.
So that's actually when this place started.
Exactly.
36 years
That's
ago.
Amazing.
I want to know, you were young. You were young to lose your dad then.
Yes.
And he was young, of course, as we know a lot of our artists and also in the African American community. We lose people too early in general. How old was your dad when he passed?
65.
Yeah.
He was 65 years old.
Yeah, see, that's called early.
Yes, it is.
But what a legacy.
Thank you.
So the reason that Lynn is really happy to that you have joined us here today is that we get to tell people about this incredible performance that's happening. So right. Who's going to go first with this? Well, Lynn, you want to set it up?
I just think it's really interesting, too, because we're talking about the passing of Howlin Wolf, and the premise of the play is really based upon his memories. So it's sort of autobiographical, but it's about his memories. And I mean, I profess that I'm going to go once a week to see this play. And everybody that's listening needs to go out to the Black Ensemble Theater and see it's called Ain't No Cry in the Blues in the Memory of Howlin Wolf. Huh. But it really does. It puts it in perspective, and what a beautiful story. And because it's Father's Day, I'm like, what a perfect time to honor Howlin Wolf. It's his 103rd, would have been his 103rd birthday.
Today?
Monday.
This past Monday.
Incredible timing.
It is.
Oh, my goodness. All right, so Barbara, you live out in the burbs at this point in time?
Yes.
And do you have any connection, either of you, I guess, to this production in a working way or in a help fellow producer way?
Well, no, but we were privy to the script before the play opened, and we did do a little tweaking, although it's not totally politically correct, but it's
God knows
the writer's imagine, you know, her creativity, mm-hmm. and it turned out to be really, really amazing. As they say, it's really in the memory of Howlin Wolf, meaning he's remembering.
We're stuff. In his. Yes, we're in his memories.
His yeah, not in you know right. tribute to him, but it's from his memory.
What a unique take to. To foist your art onto,
yes.
into the mind. What were you about to say, Betty? I cut you off.
No, I'm fine. I was about to say, I think what Jackie was doing was taking his spirit. He had gone, naturally, he was deceased, and he kind of took his memory back, walked back as if he was still here, and brought out some things. I could identify with a lot of them. Some of the things were very true. It just struck me. I was wondering, this woman is really creative, because there were little tidbits that said only her spirit and his spirit together would have known what to say and do.
Yeah, wow. The highs and lows mm-hmm. of his life, but which
correct.
Molded him into the man he was.
That's pretty remarkable, what you just said, that she got into his head spirit. That way. Because I'm guessing she probably never met him.
She never met him, no. She never met him.
See how generational artistry passes?
Yes. That's true. Rick Stone never met him, I doubt, but he can channel his spirit mm-hmm. and his mannerisms
and
really
Rick Stone
well
plays your dad.
Yes, he does. And he does it very good, very well.
Was I to understand that Rick Stone had a little practice at playing your dad before now?
Yeah, there was another play, Howling at the Moon, I believe it was in 2003. Jackie has this love for Howlin Wolf, and she, you know, when the spirit speaks to her, she starts writing it. That's what we get. It's quite a production.
See, I want to give a little nod to the musical director too, Robert Roderick, I believe.
We're appreciative to him
gosh.
Too.
Oh my gosh, the band, including Herb Walker, and and the young man, I don't remember his name right now, who plays Hubert Sumlin.
Oh yes.
Yes.
Yeah, and Muddy Waters. I mean, everybody in the play. And what I wanted to talk about, because we were together on Monday night and didn't have a chance to talk about your mom. And Lily, and what a beautiful story. And we often don't talk about the women behind the blues men, you know, and what a wonderful,
so let's.
Yes, great strength, you know, and obviously really built a great foundation for you as a family.
She did. She was actually our nucleus, because our dad depended on and relied on her, and Barbara and I surely did. Mm. She was truly a wonderful person, the best mom wouldn't want anybody else. And you know, they just partnered together, made a good family for us.
Wow. Very strong woman.
Yes.
Not formally educated, but a lot of mother wit, and together they did, you know, a lot of great things as we're still benefiting from that you would not think had happened.
Are there more little wolves?
Grand wolves. Just great grand wolves.
Two grands and one great grand wolf.
Right.
Yes.
Wow.
And what was your father's full name?
Chester Arthur Burnett.
And when did he get the name that then became his name? Do you know?
As a child,
yeah. Really?
Being devilish, and I guess his grandfather would threaten to punish him by letting the wolf get him, and from there he got the moniker.
And was that, were they in Alabama?
No, Mississippi.
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 Oh, of course.
Mississippi.
And Lynn's going to talk to us about this Blues Trail thing.
Yeah.
So I think we've talked about this play without telling people the name of it and where it is and all that sort of thing. So if you've got those details.
Yes, it is at the Black Ensemble Theater. It's presented by Jackie Taylor. It's brand new theater. It is beautiful. There's not a bad seat
in
the house.
Yes, it is.
And although opening, I have to say, I was sitting in the balcony. We were all running because it was Blues Fest, but I was watching Barbara and Betty from above, and just because I know that was the first time that you saw the play, and just channeling this beautiful production, which it's staged so wonderfully with panels on the side that actually have images from Silvio's, which hopefully the sisters will tell us a little bit about. But anyway, it's called Ain't No Crying the Blues at the Black Ensemble Theater.
Which is at 4450 North Clark now.
And it'll be running through August, and I believe it's Wednesday through Sunday.
I think so, yes.
Yes.
That's terrific. And we're going to talk with, I think, Jackie in the future on this show, who has done an incredible job of...
In this community. It's wonderful.
Exactly. To get Black Ensemble Theater a new home this past year, or maybe 2 years now. Her gift to all of us, her artistic gift to all of us.
Mm-hmm.
So what keeps you happy and busy right now?
Right now, we've started a Howlin Wolf Foundation, and that's keeping us kind of busy, enjoying every moment of it. We're able to accomplish some things because he didn't want to be forgotten, so we're using that as a start to make sure he's not forgotten, and we're getting a good response to it.
That's great.
We're going to dispense scholarships and call them with scholarships. We're going to try and help as much as we can.
Do you have a name for that foundation?
Yes. It's the Howlin Wolf Foundation, Inc. You can go on www.howlinwolffoundation.org and learn a lot about us. We've shared a lot about him. If you want to know the history, the beginning, all the way through, it's on there. I think it's an interesting website, so you can answer all of the questions that you want to know about.
Terrific.
Thank you.
Yes? And so, as far as his sort of the humble beginnings, because in the play, I mean, he came from a very hard life in the beginning. I mean, his being kicked out of his house when he was 7 years old, he left his home when he was seven to find his natural birth father.
You know, I think when you go back and you surmise things, I think even though we didn't understand and we would not have treated him that way, I think he learned from every part of, and I think that made him such a wonderful person. He understood people, he shared with people because he knew, you know, and didn't want them to experience what he had experienced. And I think that was part of what made him such a good father to Barbara and I.
Mm-hmm.
He made sure we didn't experience what he did.
Wow.
What were some of the experiences that he talked about in terms of his influences of music? I mean, Charlie Patton, Tommy
yes.
Johnson.
Yes.
Can you talk
Rice
about that
Miller.
A little bit? Yeah.
Could I you? Believe there was a Rice Miller. There were people who did two or three names. There were different people who used the same name. But I believe his stepsister married, was it Rice Miller? I believe.
Williams.
And he was watching him play harmonica and sing, you know, on weekends or whatever. I think that was probably his biggest influence. And Sonny Boy number one,
right.
Et cetera. Yeah. I guess he wanted to escape that life. And once he saw what they were doing and maybe traveling and making more money,
right.
He decided he'd take that path. And it seems like he was destined to do that, mm-hmm. just down in his soul. You know, I always say it was a part of his soul, his music.
And did he learn to howl or yodel from when he was in Mississippi?
Well, Jimmy Rogers, didn't he record
yes.
with Sun Records, and he mm-hmm. was a yodeler, and as he said, he would have looked kind of strange yodeling, so he turned into a howl, and again, going back to the childhood nickname, there you are. Yeah, that is amazing that he does that, and I just have to throw this in. When we were at the TV station, Nellie Tiger Travis was there, she was making this tiger sound, and mm-hmm. I'm like, when did she thought of that through the howling? You know, it just somehow struck me that perhaps she decided to you know, growl like a tiger, and that's her moniker. It's just something that's meant to be, I suppose.
Yeah, so how did you make contact with Jackie? What was the initial, when she was thinking this up, did she reach out to you all, or vice versa?
She had basically written it when she called for our permission, rights, and
yeah.
et cetera, but she did explain to us what was going on, and she did email the script to us for our approval, because we always like to know that there's nothing negative, you know,
sure.
quite really, really negative going on with his legacy, because he kind of was a little different and lived it a little different.
So you don't want to tell all the juicy stories? Is
well,
that the
idea? not there
come
weren't
on, Barbara,
a lot.
That's what everybody
no,
likes to. Yeah.
Well, according to him and what we knew, there were not a lot of juicy stories. He basically loved the job and did it as making a living just like any
yeah.
other man.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. He was on the job.
Yes.
He was singing the blues.
Yeah, and he was straightforward and he had a lot of rules. I mean, I wasn't there with other musicians, but from my understanding, he did it just a little bit differently, you know.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
Who were some of those musicians? And there are still some around Chicago, like Eddie Shaw. Who are some of the right. sidemen that that played with your dad?
Oh, wow. It's
Detroit Jr.
Hubert Sumlin.
Of course, Hubert, yeah. And then there was Johnny Jones. Mm-hmm. He had an array of musicians, so to speak. Sure. Hubert was always the standard, but he went through a lot of musicians, but because of the way he ran his van and the rules, if you were late or you drank or you, you know, didn't have the right uniform, then you got fined part of your check, you know, and he had some pretty strict rules, but he meant to be there on time and do the job. But back to the musicians, oh gosh, Sammy Lay played with them.
S.P. Leary.
S.P. Leary, yeah. Drums.
Who did you just say?
S.P. Leary.
Uh-huh. I'm trying to
think. Gosh, like Barbara said, it was a long list of people.
Yeah.
Plus, you were little girls.
Sonny Lance Slim.
Oh, well.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, yeah, we grew up watching them leave town, really. We weren't
right.
really a part of that scene.
Right.
He kind of separated the home life and the music life, but we would, you know, see them.
Did you ever, like, put little things in a suitcase as he was leaving? And
well, of course. And we always got some little goodies out of the suitcase.
We take them out when he got home.
It was always so wonderful when he would return home. We knew we had something special.
The gifts.
Yeah, your eyes would go directly to the suitcase.
Of course.
Hey, yeah. Hi, Dad.
Hi,
what's
Dad
in there?
Yeah, besides this brown paper bag filled with money, because he took cash most of the time, you know, afraid the checks would bounce, because he had had stuff like that happen.
Okay. Speaking of checks, there's one part which I thought was phenomenal, and our next guest will tell us a little bit about the business of music, but where a musician comes up and goes, you know, Wolf, you just gave me a check for $50, or you just gave me $50, it was supposed to be $100. Mm-hmm. And he said, well, there's taxes, and, you know,
unemployment,
so,
health
right,
benefits.
And he's looking at him going, no, but I was expecting, you know, so, you know, oftentimes I don't think musicians get the regard for being good businessmen.
Mm-hmm. Back in the day.
Right.
They didn't know the business part of things. They didn't concentrate on the business part of things. But our dad and our mom did, along with an accountant, and that was not heard of back in the day. They pretty much kept things intact. Luckily, IRS never had to walk in the door and clamp things on them, because they went forward and they ran things good. And I think Barbara and I learned a lot from that too, because we've owned businesses and we feel, you know what, that background was really great. They shared a lot of good, positive things with us.
Wow, that's great. Mm-hmm.
Well, I think, what?
One of the things I wanted to talk about was in business. One of the things where musicians do make a lot of money is royalties, obviously, from other people doing their music. And the song that we played earlier became this music for the Viagra commercial.
Yes, it did.
Wow.
And the money is in writing the songs.
Right.
Yeah, they can perform all they like, but you need to own the rights to. Mm-hmm.
Well, I think if we're going to have time to hear our next guest,
yes,
we should probably say thank you.
Thank you.
And see if we've got something set up to go out on with your dad's music.
And may we just say happy Father's Day to all the fathers around the world and to our dad in heaven.
Amen.
And thank you guys.
I say
so
that too.
And I'm sorry. Thank you guys so very much for having us. We've enjoyed it.
Oh, you're welcome anytime.
Thank you.
Here comes your dad. What do we got here?
This is Shake It For Me.
Oh,
no.
Yeah, Shake It.
It is. Oh, my God. And Rick Stone does Shake It For Me.
He does a very good job of it in the play.
Thank you, Betty. Thank you, Barbara.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Shake it, babe. Shake it for me.
Which I want to avoid. Thank you.
got a blues show today. Welcome aboard, T.L. Williams.
How you doing?
Where do you come from, my man?
Born and raised in Chicago.
Me too. All right. Of course. Indeed. And before you blow on your trumpet a little bit, you, as Lynn just said in the break, this is kind of the lineage you're following in a strong and really dignified and powerful lineage, blues players, Chicago. The train goes back to Mississippi.
Absolutely.
and part points south. And we love that connection. We love our musical heritage here.
Yeah.
How did you get started? I called you a youngster earlier. I have no idea how old you are. You have a much better watch than you should have. A youngster arm. That's
that
very
right
snazzy.
Thank you.
Where did you first get the fire for the music?
I think this is fitting for the time since it's Father's Day. The next day, it started right here, really, with the man to your left, which is my father.
Mr. Jerry Williams is on stage with us.
The family, he had a dream that he would be playing on stage with his kids. So that dream became a reality, you know, once his kids were born. And the family was a cover band. We traveled around, and that's like I started playing piano at age 4, and you know, I play 5 instruments now. I play piano, trumpet, bass, guitar, and organ. And you know, I picked that up from being around the family, being the youngest of 5, and just
you're a bit of a kind of showy guy, aren't you? I mean, you know, that's like saying you speak 5 languages. Christmas, man.
Yeah, but that's you know, always having something on in the house.
Yeah.
And each room has something different, so I just kind of universally picked that up. You know, and that's kind of where the birth of that came from. My family's from West Point. So there's probably traces of Howlin Wolf, you know, in all of us.
Let's welcome your father into the conversation. Good morning, Jerry Williams.
Good morning.
And welcome to Live from the Heartland.
Thank you.
It's a pleasure to have you and your
Thank
son
you.
Up here.
Thank you for inviting us.
Yeah, I also, you know, always have to compliment Lynn on her endless contacts in the music world that she has been enriching Live from the Heartland with.
Thank you, Katie.
Jerry, you raised your family to be musicians.
I did.
And
I
you
did.
Yourself clearly are also a musician.
Yeah, I was. I was on the road for about 7-8 years.
Uh-huh.
And
How many children do you have?
Have 5, and they're all...
That's a band.
Yeah.
Yep.
And my wife.
Totally a band.
And my wife, she's... That makes 6. But I did raise them to be musicians, and because I love the music so much myself. As a matter of fact, I used to tell them, you know, if you didn't practice, they'd come to the table to eat dinner and the plate was turned upside down. I mean, you didn't practice.
Wow.
No, just...
Well, yeah.
You meant that West Point, huh?
But no, I did. And I really take pride in T.L. because he really put the work in it. Started him playing piano when he was 4 years old. Came home one day and my wife told me, come and listen. And I came to the top of the stairs. Down there, he was actually playing Beethoven. And I asked, I said, where did you get that from? I heard it on the radio. So that let me know he was really into the music. He used to